In the middle of September, clouds were thick over the Klondike, and Tony Beats, who was king of the Klondike, was in a hurry to reach his 5,000-ounce goal. His trial didn't lead to anything, though. After finding this scary thing during the gold rush, is Tony Beats' life over? Let us find out. It looked like a big problem as soon as they started digging, but Tony was still hopeful. His main goal was the 80 pup cut, where more than 500 oz of channel gold had just been found. As long as Tony could keep the gold coming in, the veins looked good and paid well. Tony only had 900 ounces though, and the weather was making his plans fail. As it rained, the field turned into a messy mess. No matter what, Tony, who was used to being in charge, couldn't help but think about how it would affect their work. He knew just how dangerous it was, and now he had to face a new truth. This man's drive really moves me, but this task was a lot bigger than his. Tony had already planned to work 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 12 weeks ago. This showed how determined he was to get through anything that stood in his way. He did things like double the flow of water from the Trummel to fit in with the area. It was definitely an even bigger risk. It was a simple goal, get more gold. Tony was responsible for things that happened earlier in the year, because he was always eager. Still, the settling ponds weren't strong enough, and there were already signs of trouble there. Over the radio, the team said that several dikes had been broken. Tony had to make a tough choice. He had to shut down the business so he could raise and secure the dikes. In the gold rush, it took a lot of time to make the move that had to be made. They worked hard and sweated to keep water from getting where it shouldn't, because the 80 pup cut had to happen right away. Once more, the water levels were going up and Tony was against them. He couldn't let the weather decide how much money he made in mines. He told you very clearly that you shouldn't mess with your ponds. Tony told his team that they needed to start working on the project right away. Nick, a trustworthy member of Tony's team, was told to keep a close eye on this needless piece next to the pump. It never stopped raining, and the water kept coming. Tony clearly cared a lot about the dikes, and everyone needed to move quickly. He thought about how hard things were for them, and was afraid that he would sink. I believe that being patient and alert are the best things to do in this case. Nature was fighting back, and Tony was in the middle of it all. It became clear that looking for gold wasn't a fun game of cleaning bright little chunks on the patio. It was a battle with time, the weather, and AM's moods that were always changing. When I think about these problems, I can't help but wonder, will Tony Beats be able to get to his 5,000-ounce gold goal? Of course, the 80 pup had its own sparkle, but rain and rising water were against him, so his chances were not good. He was fighting to stay alive while the sound of machines could still be heard all over the area. Their digger got stuck in a settling pond. Tony knew that they would lose a lot of money every day if this big machine couldn't do its job. They had no choice but to stop. Sure, it was a bother, a huge trouble, and there was no doubt that the digging would have to stop until the problem was fixed. But Cousin Mike found a way to make things better. He tried his best when he got there in the morning, but his digger ended up going straight into the water. This caused more trouble. Tony and two other excavators went on an emergency rescue because they needed to find a way to help. They worked very hard, but it didn't help. It was time for troops, and Tony didn't think twice about sending in the 18TD6 dozer and the huge 115TD1. The question then was how to get that refuse to move backhoe out of the bog. Tony made a plan that worked perfectly because he had been digging for a long time. The first thing that had to be done was to pump out the water. To do this, the D6 dozer, a big piece of machinery, was used to push fine tailings into the pit and make a ramp. The plan was to level the ground under the stuck digger so that the big wrestler could pull it out. The colossal 115TD1 850 horsepower rescue mission star was then sent out on patrol to see if it could help. Tony came up with a way for the D11 to drive up onto the strengthened ramp, making a base for this big machine to stand on. The goal was clear: get the 220 loaders out of the mud. It was clear that things were very bad and that time was running out. But each choice came with a price. Tony Beats knew what the risks were and thought about how to fix the problem. I couldn't help but wonder if Tony's plan would work. When the engine started to roar and the machine started to turn, everyone had to help out. This was a battleground between people and nature. It was not easy to get a digger out of the ground. It was also hard to deal with things that didn't go as planned and gain skills and experience in the tough world of gold mine. The loss that Tony Beats was going through could be heard throughout the mines. The water had to be pumped out so that the digger could be taken out. It surely acted as a challenge to the muddy swamp of crisis that had caught Tony's mining business. Tony Beats, on the other hand, was not the type of person to give up. He thought they were going to get a little further along. I think things were starting to get better. The screen showed scenes of relief workers getting the stuck digger out of the way. The D6 dozer was hired to move the tailings, and a simple ramp was built to help with the rescue. They had to walk a fine line between machines and nature, and Tony Beats was determined to be in charge of it. The setting pond became less like a bog as the plan moved forward. He noticed that things were going in the right way. Exploring this swampy area visually also showed how hard things were for the workers on Paradise Hill. As the work with the backhoe went on, I couldn't help but wonder if this was another waste of Tony Beats' time. On top of that, the constant enemy Klondike weather has already slowed down work on Paradise Hill for a whole week. Even though things were getting tougher, Tony was still focused on his 500-ounce goal and stayed positive. Earlier, the backhoe problem caused them to lose about 2 hours of work. It looked like Mike's cousin was to blame because he drove the digger into the mud by accident. When Tony replied, he didn't mince words and said that Mike was stuck because the other person wasn't paying attention. With an operation being held up and a digger getting lost, will Tony Beats and his crew be able to bounce back? It was clear to him that some of his problems were caused by not paying attention to certain things. Some people made the situation funny by telling him he had to describe everything in English, Dutch, or Finnish. The task of rescuing Tony from tough situations naturally improved Tony's engineering skills. As the show goes on, all we can do is admire how strong Tony Beats and his team are. Tony Beats had to deal with this horrifying discovery. Could he get past it, or was it really the end for him? They were going to weigh the gold to see if they had reached their goal. Tony Beats was kind of riding a number-based roller coaster. It meant a huge amount, and the number of ounces meant even more. As they moved through the mine area, 9 diggers called out the count, 10, 30, and so on to keep the family on track. Some buyers saw that number as a sign of hope, but Tony would need more than 300 ounces to reach his goal. The count then got tense, 240, 250, 260. As he and the others went through rock after rock, the numbers kept going up from highs to ever higher peaks. In their whole mining project, they were either right or wrong. The ounces kept coming, 350, 360, and more. In 1987, more than $500,000 was made. It was worth $850,000, taking their total to 4,601 ounces. They worked very hard for 6 days and got a great result. The 80 pups crops helped with the success in some ways. Even though Tony knew that, at least they knew what 80 pup could do. Things have been going well with that for a while now. Tony looked into the future to see if he could get an even better number. That's why it didn't matter if they had to sling for a day. As long as gold was flowing, that was what mattered. The gunslingers didn't have any trouble with it. It was clear that they were successful, and Tony could only say that if it paid well, then it was fine. It was very hard to understand, and I was afraid that the weather would get in the way of Tony's plans. Tony was pretty happy with the outcome. It was so clear that the characters were friends and had achieved success together that it made me feel like I could relate to the miners who were fighting nature to get gold. At least for now, the never-ending search for gold has paid off. Watch my older movies if you want to learn more about how the world is changing all the time.